Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the second meeting of the Rural Affairs, Island and Natural Environment Committee in session six. Before we begin, could I ask everyone using electronic devices to switch them to silent, please? And before we move to our first item of business, I'd like to formally welcome Beatrice Wishaw, who replaces Liam MacArthur on the committee. And I'd like to thank Liam for his very brief but important contribution to the committee's work, and I would invite Beatrice to either declare any interest or say that you have no relevant interest to declare.
I have no relevant interest to declare.
Oh, thank you. So to move on to our first item of business today, it's to select our new deputy convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Liberal Democrats are eligible for nomination as deputy convener of the committee, so no seconder is required. Do we agree to choose Beatrice Wishaw as our deputy convener?
Deputy Beatrice Wishaw.
I beg your pardon. any objections? Raise your hands. No? Well, I congratulate Beatrice on her appointment.
Thank you.
Agenda item two, decisions on taking business in private. Our second item of business this morning is to agree to hold discussions about the evidence taken in private, both at today's meeting and those in the future. Returning members will remember that these discussions follow each evidence session and allow members to freely discuss issues raised during the evidence sessions. These discussions greatly help with officials when we're taking evidence as part of an inquiry and where a report is to be drafted. Are we all agreed? Thank you. And we'll now move on to agenda item three, food and drink supply chain. Our main item of business today is an introductory session in Scotland's food and drink supply chain with our key stakeholders. In this session, the first of a series of introductory sessions for the committee that we'll be holding before the October recess, and it's an opportunity for members to explore all the key issues spanning the policy areas that this committee is going to cover over session six. And remotely, I would like to welcome to the meeting our first panel. We have Jeff Ogle from the Chief Executive Food Standards Scotland, Fraser Grieve, the Deputy Director of Strategy and Communications from the Scottish Whisky Association, James Withers, the Chief Exec of Scotland Food and Drink, and Professor Mary Brennan, the Chair of the Scottish Food Coalition. And to start off, I'd like to invite Jeff Ogle to make a brief opening statement, followed by Fraser James and then Professor Brennan. Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you, Chair, and good morning to the committee. Just talking about Food Standards Scotland, our remit covers all aspects of food and feed chain which can impact on public health, with our aim to protect consumers from food and feed safety risks and promote healthy eating. We are independent of Scottish ministers and are directly accountable to the Scottish Parliament. We recently set out our new strategy for 2021 to 26, Healthy, Safe, Sustainable, Driving Scotland's Food Future, which describes our approach to changes in the food landscape, consumer interests, and our responsibilities as a regulator. Today, I'll talk briefly about some of those key challenges. And the first one is EU exit. FSS has seen a significant period of change following the UK's decision to leave the European Union. And the first one of those is with regards to recruitment of veterinary expertise and indeed meat hygiene expertise. All of our veterinary colleagues are EU nationals, and without ready access to a supply of qualified vets from the EU or elsewhere, we are now struggling to recruit our business needs. We also have similar problems in terms of recruiting meat hygiene inspectors, and changes to civil service nationality rules now prevent the recruitment of EU nationals as meat inspectors. Supply of vets in government is nearing critical levels, and we do need to see some changes in the approach we currently have with regards to our ability to recruit. We've also seen a significant range of new responsibilities, including a detailed risk analysis process for new food products, working with the Food Standards Agency, who cover England, Wales and Northern Ireland. We've established a robust science-led process for the risk assessment and approval of novel regulated food products, with over 400 applications already under consideration. This was work all that was already undertaken by the European Food Safety Agency previously. To help deliver an effective system of regulation for food exports, we have stepped up to provide support for Scotland's fishery exporters and our three centralised hubs have signed over 8,000 certificates so far this year. Again, this is a completely new requirement, as previously there were no non-tariff barriers for exports to the EU. A significant increase in demands for vets to complete certificates has fuelled salary inflation as the pool of vets is decreasing at the same time as demand for services is increasing. We're also involved in preparations for imports, which also we have a limited role. We have lost access to the rapid alert system for food and feed, and we've worked with international partners to deliver new mechanisms for monitoring food crime and food safety incidents. And ultimately, as I'm sure others will talk about this morning, ongoing labour shortages in the food supply chain mean businesses are becoming stretched. So the risk is that shortcuts are taken to meet customer demands and deadlines, and this increases the chance of mistakes in the system and risk to consumers. One conclusion from all of this is we have simply done what is necessary as a consequence of leaving the EU. But actually, the core message from us as a regulator is more nuanced than that. The EU currently remains Scotland's biggest export market, and as a third country, not just for the EU, but also the rest of the world, we need to be able to show that we have a properly supported and effective regulatory system, which is able to identify and eliminate risks from foodborne illness, undeclared allergens, or mislabeled food products. If the countries we want to export to are not assured by our regulatory oversight, then exports won't happen. On COVID, the pandemic has once again highlighted the need to tackle high levels of overweight and obesity in Scotland. And as our board has said, if obesity in Scotland's diet isn't tackled now, after what we have learnt from COVID, when will it be? The cost to the health service of treating long-term effect of poor diet are an eye-watering 363 to 600 million, and the total annual estimated cost to the Scottish economy ranges between 0.9 billion and 4.6 billion. This is the estimated total economic cost in Scotland, so includes treatment of and other indirect costs such as productivity, sick, absence, etc. An obese nation, which is where we are heading, is not going to be a productive one. Regulators are often seen as an inhibitor to innovation. Enforcement bodies that are against the industries they regulate, but I'd like to think that is not how FSS is viewed. We also know that consumers have a high degree of trust in our food system, precisely because we are an effective regulator, and since we have left the EU, our role as the national regulator has become much more significant. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much. And can I move on to Fraser now, please? And if you could, possibly we've got an hour in this session, if you could keep your opening remarks brief, because I'm quite sure the panel will have plenty of questions for you after you've finished. Thank you.
Many thanks, Convener, and delighted to appear before the committee on behalf of the Scotch Whisky Association. We are the trade body for the Scotch whisky industry, comprising about 80 members and 95% of the Scotch whisky production. I'm sure many of the members of the committee will be aware of the strategic importance of the Scotch whisky industry to the Scottish and wider UK economies. Scotch whisky accounts for about 75% of all Scottish food and drink exports and 21% of all UK food and drink exports. We employ 11,000 people directly in Scotland. 7,000 of those are in rural communities and support around 42,000 jobs throughout the UK. The industry adds just over 5 billion of value to the economy annually. But as with other sectors, the past 2 years have been very challenging. First, from October 2019 till March this year, the industry faced a 25% tariff on single malt Scotch whisky in the United States. Those 16 months caused exports to fall 600 million in that period, a 65% fall. Second, we had the impact of the pandemic, which saw global hospitality shut, tourism and business travel curtailed, and exports declined to their lowest point for a decade. And then thirdly, as the UK transitions from the EU, with businesses having to find their feet, new customs procedures, whilst the cost to some of the supply chain materials, particularly smaller producers, have been rising. There are some positive signs, however. Trade since April with the EU grew at its fastest rate than before the pandemic, growing up 31% in the first half of this year compared to last year. But exports remain 10% lower than they were pre-COVID and pre-tariffs. This is a lost growth, and the industry needs to work hard to regain that ground, working with governments across the UK and globally. Finally, with COP26, we would welcome the opportunity to spend some time exploring with the committee how industry and government can work in partnership to drive ambitious sustainability plans whilst ensuring businesses remain competitive and unburdened from complex and costly bureaucracy. The Scotch whisky industry, as some of you learned during our 100 days to go open day earlier in the summer, has committed to be net zero by 2040. This will take a degree of partnership working between industry, government and the development of new innovations. And we hope the committee will look into this further as part of its work in session six. We would be happy to host further fact-finding visits of the committee members as the new Parliament session gets underway.
Thank you very much, Fraser, and I'm sure we're all interested in a fact-finding mission to some of your businesses across Scotland. James, can I move on to you, please? Thank you.
Yeah, morning, convener. Morning, members. Delighted to be with you this morning. I'll be as brief as possible. Scotland Food and Drink, we're an industry body, membership organisation. We've got about 430 companies and organisations that are members of ours. The vast majority of them are food and drink manufacturers, and they'll range from your small artisan, new start businesses up to your long-established multinationals. The engine room of our organisation, though, is that we coordinate a public and private partnership that we call the Scotland Food and Drink Partnership. So that's 17 organisations around the table across all the main sectors of our industry alongside government and its agencies, and we coordinate the strategy to grow the sector in Scotland, across the UK and around the world. And we've been most recently working on a recovery plan to manage the impact of COVID and to adapt to Brexit. I've given evidence to the predecessor to this committee many times, that evidence probably marked by ambition and buoyancy and momentum. But as Fraser and Jeff have alluded to, it's been the toughest 18 months, probably in 20 years for the farming, fishing, food, and particularly food and drink sector. We've been very much on a crisis footing. Certainly as a result of COVID, those that were heavily reliant on exports found many of their markets closed overnight. The out-of-home market, hospitality market, is worth about £90 billion a year in the UK. That closed overnight, causing huge issues. And then folded in on top of that was the impact of Brexit at the start of this year, the end of the transition period, which brought in significant new trade barriers with our single biggest market. So something of a perfect storm. Alongside that, we have cost pressures in the supply chain, an incredibly competitive retail market in particular, and a country, I suppose, that's fairly allergic to food price inflation, so very difficult to pass those costs on down the chain. But the single biggest issue right now, if you talk to food and drink businesses, is the impact of labour shortages. Jeff's alluded to the impact it's having on them in terms of recruiting vets. I've spoken to many MDs of food and drink companies in the last couple of weeks, and I've never seen them as concerned about the potential impact on food supply of staffing shortages, and they're being felt right from farm through to fork and fishing boat through to retail shelf, with a very real risk that situation could get worse, because we're actually in something of a lull in terms of food and drink supply, and the grocery sales will continue to peak as they head towards Christmas time. The glass half full look at it, and the upside of it, is there is a recovery plan in place. We've got 17 organisations, as I say, working in partnership, delivering a whole heap of projects. They involve many of the organisations you're taking evidence from in this panel and the next panel, but there are also big challenges in what is proving quite a fragile food and drink supply chain in Scotland and the UK just now. In terms of the question that the clerk had asked around future areas of focus for the committee over this parliamentary session, I think trade issues and trade policy and trade promotion are massively important now post-Brexit, and how we help shape UK policy around that. I think this journey to net zero is absolutely critical. As a partnership, we are going to be working on the next long-term food and drink industry strategy, and would welcome the committee's views to help shape that. And I think the lessons of the last 18 months have been about how we can put more resilience into the food and drink supply chain, which I think is certainly starting to creak a little bit just now. So I'll finish my comments there, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, James. And now Professor Mary Brennan from Scottish Food Coalition. Good morning.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, members. And I really appreciate the opportunity to represent the wider civil society organisations and communities. Formed in 2015, the Scottish Food Coalition is a coalition of approximately 45 civil society organisations, all working collectively towards a just transition to a fairer, healthier and sustainable food system that works for all. Whilst a vision for a good food nation for Scotland is neither difficult to articulate nor in fact that politically contested, what is difficult is just how messy, protracted and at times interrupted progress has been towards this attainable vision. Whilst there is some mitigation to be acknowledged, as I highlighted by my other panellists, for Brexit and the ongoing COVID-19 crisis, what it has taught us all is just how precious, fragile and precarious our food system is, and how urgently food systems transformation is required. As a coalition, we bring together a diversity of interests, goals and priorities across our members' organisations, who represent public health and nutrition, environmental and nature protection, social justice, poverty, animal welfare, community action, workers' rights, farmer representatives, community growing, health and social care, and education. We also bring a broad base of interdisciplinary, internationally informed, and practically grounded expertise. We have a network, really importantly, of geographically diverse stakeholders in all communities across Scotland, and a community of practice who have lived experiences of how the current food system works against them, thriving as individuals, communities, enterprises, institutions, and places. We as a coalition actively embrace the messiness, demonstrating how barriers to systemic change can be knocked down by opening up, reaching out and listening to each other through honest and respectful partnership working. We ask difficult questions about our place within and responsibilities to our food system. We interrogate how public investment in food systems transformation can and will create and drive more resilient, prosperous and sustainable local economies and communities, including and especially those in our rural and island regions. Improvements in educational attainment, enhancements in health, well-being and productivity of our people, animals, fish and land, reductions in greenhouse gas emissions and our pursuit of net zero, and a thriving natural environment. We work to expose the different interests, power dynamics and resources available to different stakeholders, and how these influences who is heard, what sectors and markets are supported, and the balance importantly struck between domestic and export food and drink priorities. We work really hard to amplify the voices and lived experiences of those so often unheard. We reach across the political divide and the multiple governmental portfolios, civil service departments and public agencies impacted by and responsible to our food system. And through this, we are aiming to develop and working to develop evidence-based solutions to the wicked systemic problems preventing Scotland from committing to the Good Food Nation Bill and engaging in groundbreaking food systems transformation.
Thank you very much,
and
thank you all for your very informative opening statements. We're now going to questions. We've got approximately 40 minutes. We're going to touch on a number of themes, including Good Food Nation Bill, Ambition 2030 and so on. But can I ask the panel, first of all, how do you work together? You all represent different sectors within the food industry with different ambitions, but how can you work together to solve some of the issues that we're seeing and put together a coherent position, which then will feed in with the Scottish Government policies relating to some of the issues you've touched on, so that's healthy diets, social security, food poverty and so on. So how can you come together to provide a coherent message for the Scottish Government to take on board? And can I start with James?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Convener. So I think what we've got in Scotland is a good track record of collaboration. I think there's been some limits to that, which I'll explain very briefly. So as I mentioned, we have this public-private partnership with industry bodies, so Scotch Whisky Association, we're taking evidence of Food and Drink Federation, the next panel, another 10 other industry bodies alongside government coming together to develop the economic growth strategy for the industry. And it's been, I would say, hugely successful. We've gone from a static industry to one of Scotland's best performing over the period of 10 years. I think, though, that sense of coalition and working needs to broaden now. We've just heard Professor Brennan talking and Jeff talking about broader issues around dietary health and particularly net zero. So the economic growth strategy has been successful, it has worked, and to be fair to government, they have worked as good partners of that. They've given the space to the industry to put forward the strategy and they then aligned their support behind that. But if we're going to tackle net zero, dietary issues, some of the fragility in the supply chain, I think we now need to broaden that coalition as we work towards developing the next strategy. That will be critical. But I think we've got a good foundation to build on. And very interestingly, it's a foundation that the Northern Irish are now about to model in terms of that partnership working. The Welsh have already started to do, and down south, the English are planning to do through the Food and Drink Sector Council as well. So it is a proven model, but it needs to move to the next stage.
Thank you. And can I ask Professor Mary Brenn for the, on the same point, please?
Thank you, Convener. Well, I'm really heartened to hear James's position there and looking to broaden the stakeholder base. And I think that's essential to be hearing the range of voices. I think at the heart of all of what we've been talking about is that there are people, lots of different people, households, workers, producers, businesses, all who have a real stake, both economically as well as socially, in our food system. I think it's also our need to broaden, not to take our eye off the economic side of things, but also to broaden the value that systemic change can bring to our social and environmental goals. So I think that's absolutely essential. The other aspect that I'd like to note is how important it is that we think and reframe our thoughts around what we're spending on the food system and think of it more as an investment and how that investment can act as a local, regional, national multiplier, both in terms of local economies as well as sustainable communities and environmental gains.
Thank you. I'm now going to move on to a question from Alistair.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've heard from you about some of the difficulties there are. One of those difficulties we've heard about post-Brexit has been, in the past, we've looked at the difficulties in exporting, but one of the issues that's arisen more lately has been some of the concerns there are about changes coming up to certification changes in terms of importing food as well and what that means for us. Can I ask you if any of the panel, I don't know whether that would be James Withers or Jeff Ogle or somebody else, could comment on the issues that have been raised about that, please?
I'm happy to start, and then Jeff will want to add, and Jeff has been and his team are very much at the coalface of managing some of the certification requirements, particularly for getting products out of the country. But as you rightly say, as of yet, the real controls on products coming into the country haven't started. Now, that's been a source of frustration to a lot of businesses who, you know, heard about taking back control of borders as part of the Brexit debate. In reality, it's the European Union that have taken control of their borders and have resulted in a huge amount of bureaucracy and paperwork in getting products from Scotland and the UK into the European Union. As yet, our competitors in the European Union have a completely free ride bringing products into the country. That will change from the 1st of October, where the first documentary checks will start. Then the 1st of January, the first physical checks on products coming into the country will start. The reason, I suppose, that there is something of an alarm bell around that is because obviously we already have real challenges in the delivery supply chain as a result of labour shortages before we even start some of these checks coming in. And if even half the pain is felt on the import checks as exporters felt on products moving in the opposite direction, there will be real challenges. And I think it will be interesting to see if those checks on imports are delayed yet again, because I would have questions in my own mind as to whether our border posts are fit and ready to deal with the level of bureaucracy that will be required on products coming into the country. But at the moment, we haven't felt any of that pain as yet.
Okay, Jeff.
Yeah, thank you. So just to add to that, obviously, I mean, we do have importing experience already from the rest of the world. The issue here really is one of volume. The other issue is actually around capacity as well on the EU side as well. I mean, if the EU have problems with vets, for example, then certification is a problem for them in terms of their exports to the UK. So the issue is primarily one of volume and also our readiness in terms of having the required volume of border control posts, the necessary staff systems, etc., in place. And it's fair to say it is challenging. Then you will bring in, for us specifically, the issues around Cairn Ryan with Northern Ireland, and that is more complicated. So I think there are issues and there are risks. If there are bureaucratic delays, that will stop food coming in. That does actually pose some risk.
Thank you, Convener. My other question was, and you've mentioned it yourselves a number of times, the issues that Brexit has caused and other issues have caused for labour shortages. And I notice that, James Withers, you have recently written to the Home Secretary and others saying that both Brexit and the pandemic have accelerated existing pressures on labour availability. We have now reached crisis point, putting the growth, viability and security of many Scottish businesses in jeopardy. With knock-on impacts for consumers, we need action now to save Christmas. Without being unduly alarmist here, can you explain what you mean about the risks that face your industry when it comes to Christmas and more generally some of the issues that you face as a result of labour shortages?
Sure. So there are, I think, 9 of the food and drink organisations who wrote collectively to the Home Secretary and to DEFRA and to Mary Gujon as Cabinet Secretary here just last week in a letter coordinated by FDF, and you'll have David coming up in your next panel. In short, there have been underlying labour issues facing our sector, like many other sectors of the economy, dwindling working age population for a sector that is in rural areas, in areas facing depopulation, as you will well know. Massive challenges there. COVID and Brexit have come together to really push us to, and a number of supply chains to, breaking point. So 1.3 million overseas people left the UK during the course of the pandemic. Post-Brexit immigration rules make it extremely difficult for many of them to come back in. And certainly the immigration policy at the moment, for the kind of jobs that we need cover for, that immigration policy is at best ineffective and at worst is deemed hostile by the very people we need to bring in. So the shortage occupation list doesn't cover many of the roles that we require shortages for. So that will allow ballet dancers to come into the UK, but it won't allow butchers to come into the UK. And if you speak to any red meat business at the moment in Scotland, they will tell you they have a massive problem with availability of that particular job, despite the fact that a trainee butcher in a Scottish red meat business will earn more than a trainee accountant at one of the world's big accounting firms. So it's not a wages and pay thing. And I suppose that what this actually means practically, just briefly on the ground, I'll give you one example. East of Scotland Growers, a brilliant farmer cooperative in the east of Scotland, in recent days and weeks, they have had to destroy 2.5 million broccoli and 1.5 million cauliflower, healthy, nutritious food, not because there isn't demand for it, not because shops don't want it, but they simply cannot get that product to market due to staff shortages, storage is backed up. Food banks can't deal even as an option because it's perishable and because of the volumes. So we are already losing product. That will have cost that business £1 million. And as I say, this is a lull in the food supply chain calendar. And as things peak towards Christmas, a shortage on farm, a shortage in the seafood red meat processing industry, a shortage of drivers, a shortage in retail, a shortage in hospitality and chefs in front of house staff, all combines to give some very real problems. The solutions are elusive, but the single most important step that could be taken is a Home Office move to provide short-term emergency COVID recovery visas, at least for the next 12 months, so we could extend our recruitment stretch out into the EU.
Thank you, James. You touched on one particular example of the broccoli and cauliflower. I think that has been exacerbated by the crop all ripening at the same time, also because of the nature of the season we've had this year. These crops are becoming ripe at the same time as the pea industry are trying to freeze peas and so on. So I think you're absolutely right. You mentioned it being a perfect storm earlier on. I'm quite interested in the workforce argument. Certainly, Brexit will have played its part. COVID, probably even greater, with threats of lockdown meaning that some overseas workers are actually leaving to go home and not returning until it's clear exactly where we are with COVID. We've got the ageing workforce, but one of the main issues I see is we don't have the proper people to do the jobs. And I know there's examples of, with the shortage of workers, people are earning their pot of money far quicker because of the availability of overtime, and they're leaving the job mid-season, which just adds more pressure. But it's not a new problem. We've seen issues with workers for quite some time. So going forward, what plans should we be looking at to ensure that we do have the workforce in the long term? So putting aside the very serious issues we have with workforce right now, how can we ensure we have a workforce trained for the future requirements of the food industry?
So a lot of that rests on industry's shoulders. So continue to invest in fair work, the right conditions, innovative work practices, and you'll find processes moving to four-day weeks. We also, the industry's got its own job to do in order to improve the attractiveness of the sector and debunk some of the myths around that. But I do think what will be crucial is an immigration policy that can reflect where there are particular shortages in particular roles and where we have structural unemployment. I know there will be people coming back from furlough, and we clearly have people unemployed, but where those people are unemployed is not necessarily where the job opportunities are, particularly in rural Scotland. So there's a whole suite of things that need to be done. I would add into their Scottish Government support for automation and investment through grant funding, but it's going to be a whole mix of solutions. And you're right, it's an incredibly complex problem. It's not a new problem, but COVID and Brexit have pressed the accelerator pedal, I suppose, on the scale of challenge we've got just now.
Okay, thank you. Ariane, you have some questions.
Thanks, Convener. I think I'm going to address these questions to James. You're getting a good workout this morning, and also Mary. I want to explore a bit the, you know, kind of whole local food economy, and I'll just set it up a bit. We've all acknowledged that we're in the face of a climate and biodiversity emergency, and we need to, I believe we actually need to move away from mitigation and start adapting. And so I'm really interested in the whole piece around local food economy. How do we start to shorten those supply chains and, you know, look for the opportunities in local food being grown locally and then being publicly procured? I mean, I've already heard from James the challenges of just labour shortages and that kind of thing. But what other things should we be looking at in terms of, if we're moving in that direction, which has clearly, you know, been signposted, what do we need to be putting in place to remove blocks and make that more straightforward in, you know, in something that's already very complex?
Mary, shall I go?
Yes, please, James.
Okay. So I think one of the silver linings to the very dark cloud of COVID over the last 18 months has been the huge amount of support of the Scottish public and Scottish consumers for businesses in their area. So the local food movement actually has taken a step forward, I would say, but it does emphasise some of the challenges in local supply chains. So actually getting product that might be produced very close to you, actually onto your restaurant menu or onto your dinner plate, can be a challenge. There have been long-running issues around local abattoir facilities, for example, which, with the cost of regulation, is extremely difficult to make sustainable. What I would say is that within part of the recovery plan that's been developed, there are now 18 regional food groups around Scotland that now have an employed regional food coordinator tasked with a whole range of things, but includes building those links with the local hospitality supply chain. And one of the challenges that we have is that the retailers, the big supermarkets, are a hugely important market, but it's a massively competitive market. The margins are very small. Part of the reason exports have been so attractive is because of the ability to find a premium and additional margin in that. So you'll meet a lot of businesses that will say, we trade in the UK for volume, we trade overseas for profit. If we can also bring those added value opportunities really locally in the local area, that is another way of de-risking the industry and building greater resilience into the supply chain. Because whilst the food supply chain, I think, did a remarkable job in a pandemic, our world's turned upside down, and yet still shelves were stocked, the food supply chain kept moving, we have a very centralised system of food disruption, and often the most resilient supply chains are the shortest supply chains within their own communities. So I think continue to invest in regional food groups to define their own priorities and to really own that supply chain development in their own area is absolutely critical. And the more that certainly parliamentarians can do around encouraging people to buy local and support local, the more that we can keep that momentum going. So I think there's a lot of positive opportunity in the local food strategy, but a lot of work to be done.
Just building on that, James, that's excellent. And I'm really glad you mentioned abattoirs, because I was going to mention abattoirs. I think at the heart of this, Ariane, is thinking around the way in which we can leverage public food and public procurement as a real sort of core baseline market, and ensuring that that has agility and flexibility. I think it's Jenny, you're representing Argyll and Bute. Argyll and Bute has shown huge innovation in how they've responded in COVID to supporting and working creatively with their local suppliers on what is a very geographically complicated area. So I think it's showing agility in lots, in contracts, in bringing and encouraging new suppliers, mentoring and supporting new suppliers, reducing the bureaucracy. And at the heart of that actually is organisations, I think you're hearing from Colin Smith later in the next panel, are boundary spanning organisations, such in particular the wholesalers, who play an awful, a really important role in connecting and moving and logistically making it possible for local and regional supply chains to flourish. For example, we have been doing work with some in the northeast of England. J.R. Holland's an example of a company there who has worked incredibly creatively with the local authority in County Durham to be that boundary spanner, to bring the egg producers, the bread producers, the organic milk producers into their wholesale. They're originally a fruit and veg wholesaler, and to really be able to deliver for the local authorities. I think local authorities are central to this, and they are my experience with them is that they are really interested and really active and creative about what they want to do and how they can use the money that they spend, invest that money better in their communities. One last point, it's not all about food. That's an unusual thing for me to say. It's as much about the people who you're employing and the money that you are spending on those people, the investment you're making in their skills, in their careers, in the facilities, because that money stays in the local communities, and actually it stays very local because we can get ourselves tied up. But so it's as much about the people as it is about the food, and both are the sort of magic that comes together.
Thank you. We've got a flurry of hands from members now, but I'll go to Jim, who's got a quick supplementary on this, and then Mercedes before moving on.
Thank you, convener. James and Mary, really interested in the stuff that you're talking about there in terms of the local food supply chain. I'd really like to know how we build the resilience into that. But there seems to be a bit of a dichotomy. One of the biggest export markets that we have is food and drink. But the international trade policy of the UK government, how is that going to affect our ability to shorten these supply chains, keep that local touch to our food industry at the same time as trying to do deals around the world?
Jim, there's a lot of moving parts to that question, and you're absolutely right. And to be honest, this is something that, as an industry, we are rapidly trying to get our head around in terms of the food and drink having been devolved to this Parliament for 22 years, I think, now, and yet suddenly decisions around trade policy having a massive influence on the direction the industry goes. Now, Fraser is here, and his organisation are absolutely at the vanguards of trade policy and have been long before it was fashionable for the rest of us. But I think that the critical area that I would encourage this committee and the Parliament to look at in this next session is how do we develop UK trade policy in a way that reflects the particular priorities in Scotland and indeed Wales and Northern Ireland, where we have an industry that is of disproportionate importance to our economy compared to south of the border, where decisions that will be taken around trade policy in terms of agricultural imports, standards of production, will have a massive impact on the viability of the sector here. And I think we need a new type of working between devolved nations and UK government in order to inform a trade policy that is smart, that is about understanding that the decisions that we take in how we deal with Australia and New Zealand, the Pacific nations and the US will have an enormous impact on the viability of businesses and therefore their ability to meet the demand locally, the ability to build these local food and drink supply chains. And I am concerned that whilst the Trade and Agriculture Commission, I think, did a really good and really important report, I honestly don't know what has happened to that as yet. I think the Trade and Agriculture Commissioners are being recruited, but we need the scrutiny of these deals through that kind of mechanism, which can wrap in devolved nations too, to happen pretty quickly, because the decisions taken at at DIT and Foreign Office, at BEIS around trade policy, and they all play into that, will have a massive implication, I think, on viability of businesses here. A smart trade policy can be done, which can identify opportunities, but if it's not done, it could have really unintended consequences. And if we've learned anything from Brexit, is the impact of not having enough scrutiny on deals and understanding the real-world impact of them before they actually take effect.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to Mercedes, who's got a question on this topic before moving on to Jenny.
Thanks, Convener. Just to follow up off the back of Mary mentioning the role of public procurement and local authorities in the local food economy, I was interested to know what role you see public canteens, like those in schools and workplaces, what role you see them having in promoting the consumption of local food.
I see them having a key role in promoting. I'm sorry, am I echoing? No, I'm okay now. Apologies for that. I see them as playing a key role because I think they can drive some of the priority. They can demonstrate what is possible. They are also incredibly demanding food service environments. So if you can manage to deliver under the constraints, both the financial constraints as well as the spatial constraints, and the timing constraints, and if you can make seven-year-olds happy, then you have a really fighting chance to demonstrate what can be done. And I think they can showcase what is possible under a range of constraints. So I think they're absolutely key. And again, it's seeing that investment. It's not a cost. It's an investment in how we can do things differently. And also, I think we have seen, and Argyll and Bute show this, as have other local authorities, how important public food is as a core business, as a core contract to many local food businesses. It might not be the biggest part, but it is an important and relevant and often the better payers or the quicker payers for those businesses. So I think it's really important that the public food become the sort of showcase for what can be done without necessarily losing track of the economic value that we need to deliver. I think just picking up on what James said there, the other really important thing from a Scottish perspective, and it happens whether it's regional, local or national, is to remember that Scotland is very different to the UK as a unit. And I think we have to be really strong, and I think we have to be really clear about why food and drink is different in Scotland and why we may have to adopt different approaches. And part of the challenges around that is data, actually. What do we know and what don't we know, and what do we need to know in order to make the best decisions, whether they are for the domestic market or whether they're for our export and trade activities.
Thank you. I'll now move on to questions from Jenny.
I'm very aware of the work that happened within Argyll and Bute, and that was across the local authorities and also really strong local groups. Also, Fraser, it included a lot of work with the local distilleries, but more widely across Scotland, you highlighted the level of employment that distilleries have. But also, I'd just like to ask you more about, if you could go into what the distilleries' plans are with regards to sustainability, because clearly that's very important. Emissions, not only just in electricity, but also the heat that's provided, which I think is about 88% of your usage. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. I mean, I think the issue of sustainability is really important across all food and drink businesses, but across the wider economy in particular. Many distilleries have been in their communities for decades, sometimes hundreds of years, and being part of a sustainable both environment and communities is really important for the industry and its long-term viability in terms of laying down and being being around for generations to come. So we have a really tight, ambitious plan around sustainability to be net zero within our own operations by 2040, to make sure that we are using water responsibly, to really do a lot around peatland. We only use less than 1% of UK peat, but we recognise the importance of putting back and having an action plan around peatland restoration and making sure that all of our packaging is recyclable, reusable or compostable by 2025. Really kind of ambitious there. Some of the challenges you mentioned, peat as one, is something that we are really looking at in terms of where innovations can come about, where we can work in partnership. We have the Green Distilleries Fund that's trying to help establish it, new innovations to try and find solutions around this. And I think some of the solutions will be community-based or dependent on different distilleries. And I think that's something we need to look forward to, and we need to find the right innovations to help address some of those challenges.
Thanks, Fraser. Ariane's got a brief supplementary on this topic.
Yeah, thanks, Fraser. It's great to hear the innovation that you're bringing about. I guess a couple of things is, one, have you been... So I'm from Moray, a whiskey part of the world, and we've got a very good train line, and I'm really excited about the idea of getting whiskey onto rail. Have you been looking into how we go about doing that?
So a number of years ago, in partnership with Hytrans and Highlands and Islands Enterprise and others, there was a pilot project to look at whiskey by rail. It's something that we can look at again. There are challenges around picking up from distilleries and getting it to the rail halt, and then getting it to the main ports and the distance involved in that, and managing the quantity. It's something we've looked at in the past, and we'll certainly continue to look at in terms of viability. Obviously, the train line doesn't go right into the centre of the distillery area in Moray, and but certainly keen to look at all possible innovations and uses to do that. It's something we've looked at in the past and we'll continue to look at.
I would be keen to support you in doing that, because I think if we can get whiskey on the rail, you know, we can, you know, it's really pushing towards getting, you know, just rail better and you know, not as I hear what you're saying, we can't do it all, but I think we could do a lot. And the other piece, because I really see the whiskey industry is driving innovation in terms of sustainability, climate emergency, and so on and so forth, is the way in which crops are growing. So again, in Moray, we use a lot of farmland for growing the barley for whiskey. Have you been looking into innovation around how the barley's grown?
Yeah, I mean, working in partnership with the Scotch Whisky Research Institute, and there is the International Barley Hub being developed as part of the Tay Cities deal. So doing a lot to look at where new barleys and cereals can be grown and how we manage that, recognising the importance of that. I mean, 96% of barley comes from Scotland, and we're very keen to look at how we make sure that is being done in as a sustainable fashion as possible for the long term.
Thank you. We'll now move on to Beatrice, to follow by Rachel and then Karen.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. I would like to go back to the workforce issues, and Jeff mentioned the shortage of vets and hygiene inspectors. We've mentioned butchers, and Mary has said that going forward, I mean, it's about an investment in people as well as everything else that's been discussed this morning. So in terms of the Ambition 2030 plans and the need to get more people into food and drink, farming, fishing, that includes aquaculture, to bring in young people to make it a career of their choice. How do you think that we can do that? And how do you think that using research and intelligence as well, young people can see a good career ahead of them in the food and drink industry as a whole?
Mary, would you like to start on that?
Yes, I will answer that. Given my day job is at University of Edinburgh Business School, I think I can contribute to this. I think it's a really important issue because often we have focused it on more of our rural colleges and our agricultural colleges, but that's where we develop the skills and the graduates. I think further education and higher education has a huge role to play, including business schools. We have 400, 500 students a year going through our undergraduate programmes who are looking for exciting, interesting careers, which I know are offered by the food and drink industry, but they are not captured early on in their university or further education and sort of journey. I think there are definitely innovations around really interesting internships that will bring young workers and young graduates, young students into the places where we need them and give them a sort of taste for and a real sort of passion for the food and drink industry, and also to get them outside of the cities. So I love what Jeff said, that they could earn more being a butcher than being an accountant. And I have a lot that go into accountancy. So I think it is about framing, and it's about setting what this lifestyle and livelihood would look like and how it can feed into their values. Because remember, young graduates now are very value driven. They're less driven by just the salary, but the overall value and package that is being offered to them. And I believe passionately that the food and drink industry can and should be doing more with further education and higher education, and not just in those that are learning specific agricultural and food skills, but also with the broader business and social science and wider graduate base.
Thank you. We'll now move on to questions on automation, health and food from Rachel.
Well, I suppose I've got lots of questions, but I'm going to really try and narrow them down. I visited the James Hutton Institute last week to look at the vertical farming, the hydroponics, and I just presume that is something that is under discussion and as part of the Scotland's Food and Drink Alliance organisations who are actually looking at producing food with low carbon output and to meet net zero challenge. And it's really just a wide question as how that fits in with the skills challenge, the labour challenges and shortages, and the future of food production. And my second point, which I'll roll in here, which is specifically for George Ogle, if possible, which is around Natasha's Law, which will be rolled out on the 1st of October. I wondered if the industry is ready for that, and there was some scaremongering that businesses might be prosecuted if they didn't get their labelling right, and I wondered if you had any comment on that and whether this committee had a role to play in ensuring that it was rolled out, properly bringing businesses along.
Yeah, thank you. Actually, we've worked quite hard with industry in terms of preparation for the implementation of Natasha's Laws and pre-packed food. So we've done a lot of work with industry. I can assure businesses the default position is not to go straight to prosecution. And indeed, I mean, in any enforcement around food law, there's a hierarchy of enforcement, which with the first point is advice. So when it comes to application of law, if there are infringements, and obviously it depends on the nature of the infringement, and the issue is really around the pace at which we move to that. As it happens, we don't have the legal powers, I don't think, initially anyway. That still needs to be developed. But certainly the approach is always to provide advice and support first, and only if you get continuing issues do you then escalate in terms of enforcement. So the importance is to try and get compliance. Enforcement is one of the means of which you get compliance, but it's not the first means.
James, would you like to come in on that, please?
I just wanted to come in on Rachel's question in particular around, I suppose, the role of science and research in the future of the sector, because absolutely right, it's a critical point. And the one thing, obviously, we are blessed with in Scotland is having world-class research institutes and You referenced Vertical Farm, the work at the Hutton, and right across different institutes across Scotland. So they're part of the partnership work at the moment. So the Safari Institutes, the six institutes that are part of that, sit around the partnership board table. I think there's a lot more, again, that can be done there, particularly in trying to bridge the gap between science and business. There are too many businesses in our sector that go to the scientific community once they've got a really bad problem, as opposed to doing it in the start of the business development journey. Now, Interface have done some really good work in bridging the gap between business and the higher education institutes. That needs to stretch into research institutes as well. And I think there are small things that could be done that could make a big difference. For example, having scientists in residence support, where you might have scientists going into manufacturing businesses just to look at where there might be opportunities to improve efficiency, improve productivity, reduce use of resources, etc. There's even been talk about potentially funding some kits you could put in mobile vans, given businesses find it difficult to find the time to get out and get into research institutes. Can they go to them? So I think there's a huge amount that can be done, and Scotland's general draw on UK research funding pots has been poor, to be honest, and we need to get better at doing that. Part of that is down to the fact that we are more SME dominated. So a lot of the academic bodies often go as a default to the really big multinational food businesses. We have less of them in Scotland, except for probably the whisky industry and to some extent the agriculture industry. So we need to get better at pooling businesses together that have got common problems to look at bidding for Innovate UK funds, for example. So there's a bit of work industry needs to do on that front.
Thank you. Can I now move on to questions from Karen?
Thank you. I'm really interested in a few things you've had to say in terms of, you know, future proofing, particular practical implications going forward. But for in regards to the here and now, and what we can do until those practical we can implement those practical changes. Looking back over the last 18 months, there's been quite a vast, you know, diversity in certain areas and in sectors. For example, within the whisky industry, you know, we had hand sanitizer. You know, the fishing industry was more of a, you know, boat to plate type thing, and it missed out that shelf. You know, we had more fish vans, and the diversifications that we saw during the pandemic and the export issues due to Brexit really had that localized issue. And I was just wondering if any of these diversifications have maybe springboarded ideas that will be taken forward, you know, by the industry, by sectors. And in terms of, I think it was Jeff mentioned, you know, public confidence is really strong. And I was just wondering if it's because of that local aspect and the diversifications, has that maybe had an effect on that? Thank you.
Yep, James.
Shall I come in?
Jeff,
yeah. Yeah, go, Jeff.
So as James said earlier on, I think the confidence in the food system, from what we've seen with COVID in particular, hasn't diminished. And certainly when we did consumer analysis prior to EU exit, there was high degree of good confidence from consumers in the food systems and a desire to retain that. I think the issue for me as a regulator isn't around diversification and development of the market. I mean, there's many reasons why that's a good thing. I think what needs to underpin it, and this goes back to some of the points Mary made around the Food Coalition, is actually understanding and education, because food safety is actually critical to that success. And what we do know from the variety of food scandals we've had is that consumer confidence can diminish really, really quickly. I mean, horse meat confidence in ready-to-eat products dropped by 46% overnight. So consumer confidence and trust is there, but it can be quite fickle, and it doesn't take a lot for it to change. So for the diversification, what we need to also think about is actually what the education and food system support is, and training for business to ensure that food is safe, because otherwise that confidence will go very quickly.
James, do you want to comment?
Yeah, thank you, Kavina. Yeah, just very briefly. So I would agree what Jeff says around that consumer confidence piece. And one of the challenges, I suppose, is that the smaller you get manufacturing units, the more challenging it can be to manage the cost of regulation. Notwithstanding that, the regulation is critical because our brand and confidence in it is everything. So it's not often you get industries that want to embrace the regulator, but in this case, that work is absolutely critical because it underpins everything we're trying to do in terms of operating at world-class levels, and we need it, probably need a race to the top on that front. On the point of diversification, it's an absolutely valid one. And one of the things that was very notable in COVID is that hundreds of businesses became e-commerce businesses overnight. They suddenly had to find a way of getting product from their doors straight to consumers, bypassing the normal routes, selling through hotels or bars or restaurants. And that happened awfully quickly and just accelerated what was a longer term trend anyway. And again, support for companies to invest in e-commerce capability, to invest in their web development, particular SMEs, can be really, really critical. And part of a good e-commerce function is having the good behind the scenes chain, that good back office that can consolidate products and that can get products moving around the country in the right way. So I think we've seen a massive leap forward in that diversification, and that has helped businesses too. It de-risks them. They're less reliant on a few big customer accounts in order to keep the money coming in. So I think that continued support for e-commerce and direct routes to market will be critical and could be a really positive legacy out of some of the trauma of the last year and a half.
Thank you. Just a couple of questions for myself before we close. Whilst I recognise, as you say, James, we are the food industry is SME dominated, and we do have some fantastic examples of artisan producers and selling online and adding value to products and whatever. There's still a vast amount of product that needs to be processed and lands in our supermarket shelves. Do you believe there's an issue with a lack of lack of choice? So we have only a handful of meat processors, we have a limited number of abattoirs, and we know we've got a limited number of supermarkets. And I believe in the United States, and an issue there is, I think, 85% of all the food that's consumed in the States comes through about five major supermarkets. So are we facing the same issue here, where we've seen issues with abattoirs, with the pig industry? We have a very limited number of meat processors in Scotland. We have a very limited number of milk processors, and we've seen the demise of local creameries. Is that something we need to look forward to addressing in the future?
In short, absolutely. And I think the fragility of the supply chain that I mentioned is a product of the fact that we've seen a massive centralisation of food supply. There are about 24 food and drink companies that will account for about 70% of food and drink turnover in Scotland, and a very small number of buying desks that will account for the vast majority of food sales as well. Now, part of that is some fundamental questions about a cheap food system we have across the UK. So the UK sits only behind the US and Singapore in us spending the smallest proportion of our income on food. That cheap food culture has led to increased centralization. In a sense, it's been staggeringly successful. We've never had more choice, aside from current labor shortages, never had more choice at an affordable price. But there are massive issues about the potential fragility that is created because of that centralisation, because more and more power goes into fewer and fewer hands. The local food market helps to de-risk that, but I think it's something it would be very worthwhile a committee looking at, because there are some cautionary signs at the moment that it doesn't take much to rapidly destabilise a just-in-time food supply chain. And that's completely accepting we still have massive issues of food poverty and those who can't afford good, nutritious food too.
Thank you. Jeff, have you got any comments on the processing capacity?
I suppose to some extent it is determined by what the approach that governments will want to take with regards to food supply source. I mean, at the moment there's I think we still kind of import more than in terms of food supply. So, I mean, ultimately it comes down to the economic and political question around self-sustainability, I suppose. And if you move in that direction, then that drives what your policy would be with regards to food production, internal food production.
Okay, thanks. A very, very, very small supplementary from Jim, and before we go to the final question.
No, I was to make sure I got a question in. That was all. It wasn't a supplementary.
Okay, well.
It was about the Good Food Nation
Bill. Yes, absolutely. Good Food Nation Bill is one of the last questions, so go for it.
Thank you for that, convener, and apologies for the confusion. I have thoroughly enjoyed this conversation. As some of you know, I have been involved in food production and the hospitality sector for many years, and I'm hugely excited by what we can potentially do. We've undoubtedly got some major challenges ahead of us. The Brexit, COVID, the shortage of supplies, the things that are happening right now, we've got to face those challenges, but ultimately I think the Scotland food and drink industry is a massive bonus to Scotland's economy and Scotland's people and Scotland's culture. What role do you see and what expectations do you have as a panel for what the Good Food Nation Bill can deliver?
Fraser, do you want to start?
I mean, I think this is really focused on, probably better answered by some of the other panel members, but clearly we all want to make sure that we have access to high quality food and drink, and that people have trust in where it comes from and the provenance around it.
Mary?
Yes, I think building on that, Fraser, absolutely. I think it's also about, you know, people having access to and be able to afford the foods that we are wanting them to eat. But at the heart of it, I think it's about holding ourselves, whether that is government, local authorities, businesses, institutions, to account, and setting ourselves targets and ensuring that we progress. Building on what Jeff said earlier on, we cannot continue with the obesity levels that we have. We absolutely have to address the health of the nation, and food is a fundamental part of that. And I think the Good Food Nation Bill and the calls that are being made from a framework perspective and for accountability within that are absolutely essential for us to deliver on nutritional outcomes, environmental outcomes and social outcomes. And that's the magic of what this framework bill can deliver. It's complicated, it's messy, but the collective and the systemic and sort of focus of it has the power to make us a healthier, weller, more sustainable country and people.
Okay, Jeff.
I'm still on. Ah, there we go. Well, I don't think there's much more to add to what's already been said. I think the issue for us as a nation is really the diet. The diet is our challenge, and going forward, if we don't turn that tank up, then we are just going to suffer the economic and health consequences of doing it. So, any vehicle that enables us to shift the current trajectory, I think, is something we really need to consider quite seriously.
Thank you. And just finally, James, I'm going to bring you in, but I want to go around the panel again. One thing that it always comes down to is budget. So we know what the Scottish Government's policy objectives are, but do we have adequate funding in place for the food and drink related policies within their objectives? So, James, could you touch on the other question, and then I'll go around the panel again to close the session. But if you make some comments on the budget for food and drink.
Yeah, on the budget. So if we go back probably to 2005, 6, 7, there was no food and drink industry development budget at all. There was no budget line in the rural affairs portfolio. There now is something, I think, in the region of 10.5 million. So against the context of a £15 billion industry, is that enough? Well, it's been making a transformational difference. And of course, there's a much broader set of support that goes into farm policy, grant schemes, etc. But I think it's worth thinking, with the scale of opportunity we have for growth, the scale of recovery that we need to drive, and the opportunity to make some hugely beneficial impacts on local communities, as to whether that budget line should be moving north, given that the scale of it just now. So I think that's worth looking at. Do you want me to comment on the Good Food Bill, or would you rather move on?
Yeah, you can give your comments, then we'll...
Okay, just very briefly. So I've questioned a number of times as to whether the good things that have happened in terms of the food and drink sector in Scotland, you know, do we, in order to strengthen them? Do we need a change in the law, or do we need a new law? And I've struggled to come up with a legal change or a law change that's required, but I've warmed to the concept. And I think, as Mary has said, the idea in particular of putting an onus on local authorities to report against food policy, I think that is a good thing. I think it will focus minds on issues like public procurement. It will focus minds on how they're supporting local food groups in their areas. And the concept of a right to nutritious food, enshrined in a lot of UN work, is difficult to argue against. So I don't think it's a game changer, but I think if it focuses the mind on food policy, it can only be a good thing.
Thank you. Mary?
Yeah, just building on that, in terms of the budget, this is not my specialist area, but I think based on what we've been saying, I think further investment in skills and careers and building the attractiveness of the industry, I think, is central to addressing the challenges we're facing with people. But also, I think, and it's referenced in the notes for this meeting, the coherency across portfolios and across governmental departments is recognising the interconnectedness on how we are using and spending money or investing in social security and free school meals, in the child payment, investment in SMEs, in core infrastructure, whether that's transport, whether that's green energy, etc. And also, as Jeff said, treating the outcomes of poor dietary health. I think we have to see it much more holistically, while also fight to maintain and increase the share that the Scottish that the food and drink budget has to drive the sector forward.
Okay, thank you. And Fraser, beg your pardon, Fraser, your final comments, and follow with Jeff.
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, one would be ensuring that food and drink is embedded in the promotion of Scotland around the world, recognising the reputation of Scotch whisky and the role it plays in Scottish tourism, where 2 in 3 visitors to distilleries would usually be from overseas. Support for innovation to find solutions around sustainability, heat issues and so on. And then infrastructure, addressing issues like the Rest and Be Thankful, and of course ferries would be helpful too.
Thank you. And in conclusion, Jeff.
Yeah, just two quick points. From an FSS perspective at the moment, our budget is okay. We'll have to see how that goes going forward. From a local authority perspective, particularly around environmental health, there are particular issues there. Resources, some of that issue. But I also think the challenge for us as a regulator is also around innovation and how we use, for example, digital and other means to ensure we have an effective regulatory system. So I don't think it's just resource. It's also about how we actually regulate as well is going to be key.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank you all for your comments. And we'll certainly take them on board when we look forward to put our work programme together. It's been very helpful evidence session, and thank you again, and we'll briefly suspend the session to allow the witnesses to change over, and we'll restart at 10:15. Thank you. Welcome back, everybody, and welcome to our second panel. We have the panel today. We've got David Thompson, the Chief Executive of Food and Drink Federation Scotland, Martin Reid, the Director for Scotland and Northern Ireland for the Road Haulage Association, Peter Chima, Chief Executive, and Dr. John Lee, Head of Public Affairs from the Scottish Grocers Federation, and Colin Smith, the Chief Exec of the Scottish Wholesale Association. I'm going to invite David Thompson to make a very brief, and I'll stress a very brief, we're limited to an hour this morning, so a brief opening statement followed by Martin, Peter, and then Colin. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you, and I will be very brief. So the Food and Drink Federation is a trade association of food and drink manufacturers in Scotland, representing Scotland's largest manufacturing sector, employs 47,000 people, and has a turnover of around £11 billion. We have membership of over 900 members across the whole of the UK, and in Scotland we represent many famous Scottish names and also UK and international businesses who manufacture in Scotland. I was asked to talk about key issues and some key elements for the committee to consider going forward. So the key issues, as we said just now, are a very fragile state of the industry, rocked by the kind of continuing explosions of Brexit, and we're not through that process yet, significantly affected and changed by COVID, and facing at the moment a labour shortage, which is unprecedented. So at the moment, there are a lot of things where the industry feels fragile. However, we have a strong background, a strong baseline in growth in Scotland, and a robust industry which managed to get through COVID and change and adapt for that over the course of the last year. So lots of things to be positive about as well. I think there are probably four or five things I would highlight. Food and Drink Federation works on behalf of the wider food and drink industry in Scotland to do two things. The first is to support careers and careers advice through our A Future in Food programme. And secondly is to support small and medium-sized enterprises to reformulate through our reformulation programme. Both of those are supported in different ways by the Scottish Government. Those are going to be key things as we move forward, and in particular when we talk about some of the key issues that are coming forward. So the first one is obviously around health, obesity and potential health regulation. The Scottish Government had previously proposed health regulation. It sensibly dropped that in the face of the pandemic, but obviously we await what comes in the programme for government. And also there are new health regulations being brought in place in England, and how those regulations impact on each other, impact on businesses in Scotland, that's going to be critical to understand. The second area is around environment. We obviously have the introduction of the deposit return system coming, but we also have the race to net zero. Now, the food and drink industry is an important part of the discussion around the race to net zero, and that has to be one of the key things that the committee considers. We've also got trade deals, and I know you've talked a lot about that in the previous session, so I won't go into that in detail. But there's two other things I would probably highlight. The first is the impact of our new status as the UK out of Europe. So things like the Internal Market Act, differences in regulation in different parts of the UK, it will be important for this committee to understand that and to monitor what goes forward. And in particular, as legislation begins to needs to be brought in terms of what would have been decided at EU level before, then obviously food and drink has a significant amount of technical and health regulation associated with it anyway. And again, the committee will need to understand how it's going to interact with those wide-ranging but very technical changes to regulation that are due to come forward. So I'll stop there, but there's a lot more to talk about, I think.
Thank you. And move on to Martin.
Good morning to everybody on the panel. The UK logistics sector employs 2.54 million people, It's worth about $124 billion to the UK purse. 98% of the goods of the UK will spend some time on the back of a truck. And 85% of the UK operators are SMEs. So just one or two bits for context here. Now, the RHA have around 9,000 members within the UK, 900 in Scotland and Northern Ireland. And although we have in membership 90% of the motor transport top 100, 80% of our members have 1 to 20 vehicles. In terms of scale, there are 76,000 operators licensed in the UK. Scotland has about 5,500 of those. 2,400 are standard national. Only 555 are standard international, and the rest are on account. So the vast majority of goods that are moving in the UK haulage sector are still within the UK. The biggest ticket item that we have just now, and is well publicised and it affects all the other supply chains, is our driver shortage. Now, pre-Brexit, estimations were that we were between 50 and 60,000 drivers short. At that time, there was about 15,000 Eastern European drivers operating in the UK. As James pointed out in the morning's session, a lot of these people have gone back, and it's difficult for them to return under the current regime. We have an ageing workforce as well. The average age of an HCV driver is 55 years old. Only 2% of UK drivers are under 25, and only 1% are female. So we have a lack of diversity, we have an ageing populace, and we're reliant on new entrants every year to cover those who are leaving. Normally, a DVSA would do roughly 75,000 HGV tests in a year, and the pass rate is just above 50%. But last year, because of the restrictions through the pandemic, they were only able to do about 35,000, so 40,000 HGV tests short last year, which puts us in a position, and people have used the phrase perfect storm quite regularly, but what has happened because of Brexit and the pandemic has made an existing problem exacerbated further. Now, the knock-on effect is that our members and HGV companies right across the UK are moving goods for the construction sector, the food and drink sector, you name it, we're part of the supply chain. And when there's a deficit in the amount of drivers, it means there's a deficit in the amount of deliveries that are happening. So there's very few supply chains that are unaffected by the shortage that we're experiencing in our industry. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. I'll move on to Pete and then finally Colin, please.
Good morning, convener, and thank you very much for the opportunity to provide evidence. We were formed in 1918 to ensure the supply of essential products in the aftermath of the First World War. Scottish Grocers Federation is the national trade body for convenience store industry. Now, a short opening statement to the committee will touch on three areas. Number one, the convenience sector in Scotland. Two, the SGF's and Scottish Government's Go Local programme, which connects with local retailers and local suppliers. And finally, the challenges of the supplying island communities. So the convenience sector, there's 5,000 convenience stores in Scotland, directly employing 42,000 people. The value of sales annually is about 4 billion, and the sector contributes 530 million to Scotland's economy each year in gross value added. Now, over the course of the pandemic, the number of stores in Scotland has remained stable. However, 5,000 jobs have been lost. Our working assumption in relation to the reasons for that is, in order to stay open for business, stores have had to cut jobs. Convenience stores are at the end of a complex supply chain. Most convenience stores in Scotland have a close relationship with a large wholesaler. This allows them to stock a wide variety of products from a wide range of categories. The connection with the wholesaler is part of the supply chain has enabled convenience stores to remain relatively well stocked through the pandemic. But to remain competitive, convenience stores have had to maximise their selling space within stores. stock is generally controlled on a just-in-time and with it being increasingly facilitated by a tablet and an app technology. Another aspect of ensuring competitiveness is a significant growth of food-to-go offerings within convenience stores. Now, that's made it absolutely vital for convenience stores to build a strong business relationship with local suppliers, sort of bakeries, butcheries, dairies, and so forth. And within the food service companies also for catering style ingredients. And that means more and more parts of the supply chain have become embedded within the convenience store. So the overall effect of that has meant that generally convenience stores have diversified their range of suppliers. And additionally, as owner-occupied businesses, convenience stores have become very, very flexible. They make decisions quickly and respond to changing customer demands. Taking that together with things that have enabled the convenience stores to fare relatively well during the pandemic. Now, the connection with the local suppliers will grow as an importance over the next few years, and that is why, in partnership with the Scottish Government, we developed the Go Local programme. The Go Local programme was designed to aid the economic recovery of the regrowth of Scotland's food and drink sector by increasing the sale of Scotland's local products in the convenience sector to help mitigate losses in other channels as a result of COVID-19. It really aims to support the convenience stores throughout Scotland to provide a dedicated long-term display space for locally sourced products with a bias towards fresh and healthy, coupled with enhanced consumer engagement and supporting retailers achieve this through a Scottish Government match-funded scheme. Now, the pilot was launched last year on the 1st of December 2020, following a robust selection of process, we chose 10 geographically and demographically diverse stores across a range of fascia groups to prove a proof of concept. Now, each of the stores received a grant funding to enable them to maximise the range of Scottish products they offer to customers, which in turn enabled stores to support local Scottish producers and give these business a vital route to market. Much as there are many common product ranges across stores, the programme deliberately was flexible to ensure that areas developed and ranges introduced are right for each store. This approach really allowed us to deliver a diverse range of products from in-store butchers to our food-to-go operation. Now, the trial has been hugely successful and resulted in a 34% increase in the number of local products stocked, thanks to a much more space-dedicated system, and a 40% rise in sale of local produce at shops that took part. And across all stores, the performance of Scottish products outperformed the rest of the store. Now, the data we gathered has been quite significant, and the participating stores clearly demonstrated the value of the initial investment, particularly in creating a multiplier effect, which other colleagues talked about in the morning sessions, which really benefited from the entire value chain. The average annual local multiplier effect per store was roughly £694,000. Based on retail scanning data, which was provided for all Scottish products, and the average local multiplier increase of just over £220,000 per store, and just under £160,000 of which was Go Local compliant products, and the remaining £64,000 increase coming from non-compliant products, which is an unintended benefit from the focus on Scottish products. So the annual local multiplier increase of just under 1.6 million on compliant products based on applying the average to 10 stores. And extending that over the life cycle of the six-year program, the local multiplier benefit is just under £9.5 million. So, you know, we've seen a further benefit of just under £4 million from non-compliant products. Pete. So what are the key learnings from all of this?
Sorry, Pete, I'm going to have to stop you there. I'm sure some of the topics you've got to cover will be brought up in questions. We're just tight on time. Can I move on to Colin for a brief opening statement, and then we'll get on to some questions, please. Thanks.
Sure.
And thank you for inviting us to the committee this morning. The Scottish Wholesale Association are the official trade body of Scotland's food and drink wholesale distributors. Prior to the pandemic, our sector was worth £2.9 billion and employed over 6,500 people directly. Wholesalers are the wheels to Scotland's food and drink industry, supplying the 5,000 convenience stores that Pete's just talked about, as well as supplying into the 30,000 hospitality, tourism and leisure businesses, as well as all of Scotland's public sector hospitals, schools, prisons and care homes. 90% of our sector is made up of Scottish family-run SMEs, and when the pandemic hit, it had a devastating impact on them. Some were operating only 5% of pre-COVID sales right up until April of this year, when restrictions began to ease. This was particularly evident in the more rural and remote parts of Scotland, and where they are more heavily reliant on tourism. And it was also particularly noted within the on-trade wholesalers that purely service licensed hospitality venues. Even with the economy starting to fully reopen, our fifth wholesale market report in July showed that 37% of members were still trading at a loss. The Scottish Government's Wholesale Resilience Fund, awarded to many wholesalers last December, was genuinely a lifeline to their survival. However, just as members were expecting customers to reopen in January, the economy remains closed and no further financial assistance has been forthcoming for our sector. That is despite real needs amongst some of our wholesale businesses. To compound matters, wholesalers are now being hugely disrupted by the wider supply chain issues that the previous speakers have spoken about. Members are facing their own staff recruitment challenges, particularly drivers and warehouse staff, but there's an even greater impact on food availability coming into our warehouses and act as the largest for those customers that we supply, those being disrupted as a result of workforce gaps elsewhere in the supply chain. But despite the challenges, SWA have embarked on a rebuild strategy for our sector, and that includes the creation of the local supply chain education and training programme for the producers and suppliers selling into the convenience stores that Pete talked about again, and then the hospitality. And we've set up a decarbonisation of the wholesale industry project. I'd be happy to share more information on both of those projects with the committee, and I even invite the committee to come and visit a wholesale depot near you and see for yourself what we do. And that is me. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Colin, and thank you all for your introductions. We'll now move on to questions from members, and we're going to start with Mercedes, who's got a question on access to labour within the food and drink supply chain.
Sorry, it was a question about rural areas and islands.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead.
I just wanted to know if you're aware of any ways in which island and rural infrastructure can be improved to ensure compliance with animal welfare, environment and biodiversity standards, and how best that can be supported by Scottish Government.
And would Martin like to kick off?
I'll be honest, I don't have an answer for you there. It's not something that I have any kind of level of knowledge about there. I do apologise.
No, it's quite all right. Would anybody like to raise their hand if they'd like to address that question? No? Okay, well, we'll move on to another question on the labour supply, and that will maybe stimulate some conversation. We've heard about the issues with haulage, and we know it's not unique to the United Kingdom, where we've also got examples of, you know, Poland has about 150,000 drivers short, and Germany. So the UK certainly is not unique in facing problems with haulage. Martin, can I ask you, what interventions do you think the Scottish or the UK government could make to address the short-term problem. What short-term initiatives could see a reduction in the issues we see with haulage at the moment? You touched on tests. I know that's a reserved matter, but you know, social distancing or whatever when it comes to test centres is down to the Scottish Government. Speed limits, tachograph hours, where do you see we can make some quick improvements to address some of the issues?
Well, we put a number of suggestions into the government. Firstly, I don't think that the driver's hours is necessarily the way ahead, because all you're doing is you're increasing the workload for those who are already under stress and underrepresented. So that's not necessarily the way ahead. We, as the panel this morning mentioned, one of the issues that we need the government to look at is the shortage occupation list. We also think that, in accordance with what James Withers was mentioning this morning, that a short-term visa would allow intervention or allowed some of those who have left to go back to Europe to come back and work while we are effectively trying to grow our own wood, as it were, because that process all takes time. We have also asked the government to look at the existing youth mobility scheme, which allows non-EU youths to come in and work here for a period of 2 years. And we feel that if that could be extended to EU workers as well, then we could potentially get some a small influx of drivers who could help potentially for a short term. So I guess those would be the short-term measures that we're asking for. Another point would be that the industry pays an awful lot of money into the as a training levy, but only about 10% of that is drawn down. So we need a review of the training levy and to see how that can be best used at the end of the day. There's an awful lot of training going on. A lot of companies all across the UK, and Scotland is no different, are looking to train, but that all takes time. And as we've mentioned before and was mentioned in the morning call, there is a problem of immediacy just now with existing orders that need to be filled.
Thank you. And I've got a supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
Thanks. It's directly to Martin, please. In your introductory statement, you said that normally 75,000 HGV drivers would be taking the test, whereas 35,000 due to COVID were taking them. So can I ask if you've fed into the UK government consultation, well, through the DVSA, on rolling the, you know, rigid and Arctic testing, and how quickly do you think that, if that consultation is successful in terms of rolling those two tests together, it will feed new lorry drivers into the system?
Yeah, we're feeding back on that. The consultation is still live just now, but that we are feeding back into that, and we are of the opinion that using our amalgamating the C plus E, or being allowed to go to C plus E without the need to do C class first, it would certainly speed things up for the first instance, because in terms of the training side of things and the safety side of things, which nobody wants to compromise on, no trainer worth his salt would ever put somebody through for C plus E if they had concerns of them while driving a rigid. So that side of things, we think, would definitely speed things up. On the safety side of things as well, the other parts of the consultation, we're keen that they don't bypass B plus E, which is obviously for towing caravans, plant, etc., etc. We can't compromise on the safety side of that. So there are ways of speeding that up. Delegated testing is another thing that we're looking at for perhaps the reverse part of the training could be done at the trainer site rather than DVSA. So, yeah, there's a number of things that we have in that consultation response. But, yeah, that's a key thing. We also feel that we should be prioritising HGV tests over car tests just now, because at the end of the day, this is a real shortage that's affecting all supply chains. And so we kind of need as many hands to the pump as we can get to get people through their tests and get the available slots through.
Thank you, Martin. I'm now move on to Beatrice to be followed by Jenny.
Thanks. Good morning, panel. I'd like to ask Colin about the supplies to wholesalers, particularly in rural and island areas. And we saw at the beginning of the pandemic that there were situations where supplies weren't getting through, particularly if you were at the end of the supply chain. So I wondered what the experience was at the moment. I mean, I've heard locally of supply issues. So I wondered if you could expand on what's happening at the moment in terms of getting supplies to the smaller wholesalers and in frustration as sometimes expressed that you can see the goods that a wholesaler is trying to bring into the community and you can see it on a supermarket shelf. So I wondered if you had any comments on that.
No, thank you, Beatrice. Good to see you, and certainly I know that you're engaged with those in your local community, supplying the public sector and as well as the local convenience stores. You are right. Scotland, as a country, is at the far end of the supply chain. We are reliant on the goods coming up from England or even further afield from Europe and coming through the ports of Dover. It's always been a bit of a challenge, but certainly Brexit and COVID has compounded that further. Even more so, those that are based at the furthest ends of Scotland into the Highlands and up into the Islands. Just to give you a sense of, you know, our sector. So it's, as I said previously, 90% are small Scottish family SMEs. We operate around about 115 depots located across Scotland. But if you look at where they are located, 50% of our depots are located within the central belt of Scotland, that's from east through to west, and 14% are based up in the Highlands and Islands. And you know that becomes a commercial decision for the suppliers. Where are they going to send the goods? Is it to the 56% where they can be guaranteed volume and capacity of filling vehicles, or is it to the 14% that don't require as much because there's not as many mouths to feed and areas that are heavily reliant on tourism where there now isn't any. The unfortunate piece is that the 14% aren't getting the supplies. Pre-COVID, availability into our sector as a whole was running about 98%. So if you're ordering 100 cases, you would expect to receive 98 of them. Since COVID and especially EU exit happened, that average has now dropped to around about 85% to 90% in the central belt, but up into the Highlands and Islands, availability has dropped to between 70 and 80%. Compounding that is the fact that the cost to serve to those local rural communities is a lot higher. Those suppliers are increasing their minimum order values or the minimum quantities to those islands to maximise space in the vehicles and also reducing delivery times. So where they might be used to get a delivery once every fortnight, it's now once every month. So the problem that islands and Highlands and Islands have got is that if availability is only 70% of what they're asking for, they're now not able to replenish that and fill that gap for another 4 weeks. So there's double the amount of problems. It is a concern, and you know, is it going to get better? No, it's probably going to get worse before it gets better, especially as reliance on the goods come out from England and the pressure of schools opening in England, offices now going to be going back. You know, it's a real worry for us.
And just a small supplementary on that from Rachel.
Colin, on the logistics and the warehouses, particularly Bells Hill and Central Scotland, has there been a problem with pickers?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, we're not immune to the problems that RHA have just spoken about. We've got a shortage in drivers, but we've also got a shortage in warehouse staff. Since March, we've had basically a leaky bucket. We've had a shortfall in drivers of about 13% across the sector, but we are now also struggling to find warehousing staff. And it's not because our sector has been reliant on EU nationals, which have now gone home. It's a problem. The economy has you know, looking for employees, and people are moving to other sectors, other industries. Availability is in the Central Belt, Bells Hill, Glasgow area, around about 20%. In Edinburgh, it's running about 30% of warehouse staff required. Interestingly, we are not so much affected up in the more remote areas of Scotland, either by driver shortages ourselves or warehousing staff, because there's not the same opportunity for people to move around, so people are tending to stick. But I know in the islands, as businesses are starting to come back and tourism come back, they are going to be looking for staff, and there's only a finite number of home grown employees available. So we have a shortage in staff for warehousing and drivers.
Can I move on to Jen for her questions, please?
Great, thank you. Thanks very much. That was quite a dark picture you painted there, Colin. And living in an island, I absolutely know how important our local shops are. They're absolutely central to rural communities across Scotland. And throughout the pandemic, they showed their fleet of foot, I suppose, by changing where they got deliveries from and perhaps getting more local and working with different people and suppliers. So I'm interested to know how you're going to continue to ensure that that happens, given what you've just said, Colin. But also, we've had stark warnings about Christmas. And if we're in this situation just now, we heard from the last lot of evidence, I'm interested to know what you're putting in, what train you're trying to, or improvements you're trying to make to help in that situation. Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, the wholesalers have always been fleet of foot, especially the smaller ones that are more nimble and able to adapt try and get supplies from other sources, but it is difficult. That, you know, it is the same suppliers buying a local SME wholesaler as it is a multinational or into the supermarkets, and is back to this, you know, where is preference of sale going to go to? Is it going to go to the larger multiples, the larger national wholesalers, or those smaller SME wholesalers? You know, many of our members did pivot at the start of COVID to direct to consumer to help the local communities stay, survive, and to help sell the stock through that they were lumbered with the closure of hospitality. I mean, I certainly don't have the answer necessarily for how we're going to ensure that we've got enough turkeys or you know, other Christmas delicacies, and that's in the hands of the producers that we're reliant on, and that they have the difficulties in producing those. Well, in terms of local supply chains, and we will come on to that, I spoke about that local food supply chain project that we're doing, and it's about actually ensuring that we are more engaged with the local producers and using local food and drink, and getting that into our vehicles and distributed to the convenience stores and the hospitality, rather than being reliant on the long supply chains that we currently are. It's probably going to be longer term and not short term necessarily, a necessary fix for Christmas, but we will do our best, as all I can promise.
Could I ask Pete or John's comments on the same topic, please?
I'm happy to say something on that, Convener. I think, as Pete alluded to in his opening statement, I think one of the strengths of the convenience store sector over the past few years has been that they have diversified their supply chain to some extent. We've seen a big move towards engaging and developing business relationships more with local suppliers. And the Go Local project that Pete mentioned has been specifically set up to move that forward and increase the space that convenience stores can offer to local suppliers. So I think that diversification in supply chain has been a big plus factor for the sector over the pandemic, and I think it will continue to be so. And I guess one of the key take-home messages from today is that we think diversifying that supply chain and creating relationships with local suppliers is very much the way that we think the food supply chain in Scotland should develop. Just to highlight one of the issues that we're trying to address is that I think a lot of manufacturers in Scotland are still not convenience ready. Historically, they have been able to scale themselves up to supply the larger retailers, but the knock-on impact of that has been that the convenience channel has been kind of closed off to them. But we're very keen to open up the convenience channel to a much greater range of manufacturers in Scotland. So we're doing some interesting work with Scotland Food and Drink on that. I'm sure there's more work we could do with David and his colleagues on that. But I think developing those local supply chains, developing those local connections with Scottish manufacturers and ensuring that manufacturers are convenience ready, if you like, is one of the key factors, I think, in moving forward from the current situation.
Thank you. We'll now move on to questions on impact EU exit. Karen.
Thank you. I find this discussion really interesting, actually, and you know, in terms of the local aspect over the last 18 months and seeing how everybody's you know, involved in what parts to play. What I would like to ask is, you know, in terms of you know, Brexit's impact on the food supply chain, is there any sectors in particular that have been highlighted as having you know, ongoing issues at this moment? Seafood, for example.
Maybe David Thompson to come in on that.
If I could start, thanks. Yes, there are some sectors that are more significant or at least have been. But I think that anyone essentially who's a small and medium-sized exporter who would previously have exported to the European Union and relies on a groupage, so relies on their orders being consolidated with others, anyone, it doesn't matter which sector you are, has found that really difficult. And many, many of our smaller members have said that they've given up on trying to export just with groupage and paperwork and logistics. Are just too difficult. Others have profited, and in particular, if you're able to send a whole lorry load of something, then you can manage that paperwork and the risk yourself. But if you were sending your products with a range of other companies, then there's too much risk there. And so many people have actually exited exporting to the EU until things can. So that's it's not necessarily a specific sector at the moment. It's small and medium-sized exporters.
Can I ask just a supplementary on that, David? You know, one of the issues was that when small consignments were sent as part of groupage, the individual cost was a real barrier. Can you see that being addressed and that barrier, the cost barrier, being removed anytime soon?
Unfortunately, not really. I mean, there are ways to do it, I'm sure, in terms of paperwork, digitisation, and so on. But the real issue is that I think is the risk associated. You're putting your product in a lorry with lots of other people's products, and you're reliant on them to also get the paperwork right. And I think that's the bit that both the hauliers and logistics companies and individual businesses find, you know, it's too risky for them to take things forward at the moment.
Okay, thanks. Can I maybe ask Martin's thoughts on the groupage issue in particular, because we know that was one of the main issues early on. Is that likely to continue and cause problems for your members?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, David's hit the nail on the head there. Anybody who was involved in groupage felt an incredible amount of pain at the turn of the year. Goods are getting through, small amounts are getting through, but nowhere near the volumes that we were used to pre-Brexit. The lack of qualified customs agents right across the UK and through the supply chain, and it has to be said also in Europe, has meant that for those who want to continue to move goods in that way, are effectively having to become their own customs agents. So that adds an awful lot of cost and an awful lot of bureaucracy and paperwork to what was previously fairly simple work to carry out.
Thank you. We're now going to move to the topic of local food economies. Can I ask Ariane for her questions, please?
Thank you, Convener. So it's been actually really, you know, challenging to hear what you have been faced with and the people you the businesses you represent. But I am also heartened to hear from Pete and John about the movement for convenience stores. I would say maybe they become neighbourhood stores to already be taking that initiative around local procurement. And I can see, you know, we are going to be doing a bit of work in the Parliament around 20-minute neighbourhoods in this session. And I think you're already leading the way in that, which is great. But I actually would like to ask questions about related to climate and net zero. So probably directed to Martin and Colin on, you know, so Colin, you were talking about the difficulties of Brexit and COVID, meaning that food wasn't reaching the islands and the rural areas. I just wonder if you've been doing any thinking about, you know, clearly climate is impacting, you know, country food producing countries in the south, in Europe. You know, what are we going to be looking at in terms of the impacts from climate? That's one bit. And then the other bit is in terms of, you know, the haulaging part and the emissions from transportation.
So the Scottish Wholesale Association sit on the Retail Steering Group and the Tourism Task Force and were integral to the success of both Ambition 2030 and the Food Tourism Strategy. So everything you have spoken about in terms of climate and food distribution is pertinent to all of the strategies going to be coming out of those groups. So in terms of true local supply chains, you know, it's important that we get the goods into the vehicles, into the wholesalers' vehicles that are servicing the convenience store sector that we're talking about, and the hospitality, and that we do that in a way that is both efficient and, I'll say, carbon neutral. So the two projects I alluded to, the local sourcing or delivering growth through wholesale, actually does what John was talking about a second ago, and as an education training programme in conjunction with SOS, with some funding from the Scottish Government Recovery Fund being delivered in conjunction with Scotland Food and Drink, and that is the education piece of local producers understanding the wholesale route to market and the advantages of using the 1,400 trucks that we put on the road, the 70 wholesale distributors and 115 depots that we can distribute through, and the 6,500 employees that we can help, you know, get their goods onto the shelves, onto the plates, etc., and act as their sales force or the accountancy team, etc., etc. So using that, and then coupled with the decarbonisation project that we launched in January, the first phase of which is nearly complete, we'll share the findings with the committee, and that is looking at how we decarbonise the wheels, and particularly the trucks, those 1,400 trucks. We already know the figures because we've just done the analysis, and what is the solution for those? It's not going to be diesel, it's not going to be petrol, and it's not going to be electric. It's most likely going to be hydrogen, and we're partnered with Arcola and a project to get a hydrogen vehicle onto the roads of Scotland, and that's with the Department for Transport Shift project, and working with Hydrogen Accelerator, Scottish Power and others to look at how, you know, we have carbon neutral local supply chains, sustainable supply chains, and, you know, that are creating those 20-minute neighbourhoods that we're trying to establish. So it really is ticking all the boxes of Scottish Government's ambition and the race to 2045 and net zero. I don't know if that's answered the question fully, but hopefully it's given a more flavour of what we are doing to help, you know, decarbonise and create a greener, more sustainable food and drink supply chain.
Thank you. And Martin, maybe you would like to say a little bit of your thoughts on the haulage world?
Sure. Since 2013, the haulage industry has reduced emissions by 65 to 70% just now, and by 2025 that should be around about 80%. The Euro 6 engine is categorised as ultra low emission, but we realise that that's not good enough, and we need to move forward. As Colin was saying, we realise that the future is not necessarily diesel, petrol, or perhaps electric. I mean, the I'll give you an example of I mean, there are tests going on all across the UK and trials going on with various different products and various different methodologies. I was given the example of a type of shunter that's used. It's called a Terberg, and a diesel Terberg costs £92,000. An electric Terberg is £380,000. So that's a massive amount when you think you could be running 15, 20 of those. That's a massive outlay. And what we're finding is that when the conversations are going on, we are 100% behind the net zero plans and the aspirations. The concerns that we have are around barriers to entry and stranded assets. It's not so long ago that the government were pushing for everybody to have Euro 5 trucks. Now, if you're going to go into low emission zones or gases, then you must have Euro 6. As a result of that, the value of Euro 5 has dropped through the floor and the price of Euro 6 has gone up, which means the barriers to entry are greater. So we're 100% behind the aspirations. Our concern is particularly going back to those SMEs who want to engage with it in this agenda, that the barriers to entry remain achievable. It is far better if we can bring the industry along with us than have the stick constantly beating them with it. So yes, we are 100% behind it, but we warn against stranded assets and the value of existing materials and consideration to be given to existing cycles. The average usage of a truck normally for a company would be about 12 years. Now, if you're thinking that, you know, each, in rough figures, a tractor unit would be around about £100,000, and halfway through that payment cycle, it's rendered useless because of, you know, legislation, then that's, they have to take the hit on that plus the cost of the new unit. And that's a lot for businesses to. So what we're saying is that 100% behind it, but we need to be sensible in terms about recognising the fiscal effect that it has on businesses who want to engage. We had a situation not so long ago where a big company through the west of Scotland were looking at gas trials, and so much so that they had built a unit through a new house, which they allowed others who were trialling that, vans, etc., to use that as a fill-up point. And then out of nowhere, BOC said they were no longer going to deliver to Scotland because they didn't have the economies of scale. So that rendered that trial completely useless for not just the company that was storing it, but for those who were doing it. So there's difficulties engaging with it, but the will of the industry is 100% behind it. We all want to run greener vehicles. We all want cleaner air for everybody around us.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Mercedes in for a supplementary, then I'll come back to you, Ariane, for your further questions.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, it's really exciting to hear all the changes that the industry has planned. But as Martin pointed out, there's financial barriers and the targets need to be achievable. So I'm just wondering what the panel would say are the policy changes or the resources that Scottish Government could do to support the food and drink supply chain to meet these targets and to continue to make the changes that we need to tackle the climate emergency.
We could maybe ask Colin to come in that again initially, and then David Thompson.
No, certainly. I agree with everything that Martin said. Obviously, if our members are owning trucks, they face the same issues that Martin's just alluded to. So I think, you know, part of the reason that we got involved in this decarb project is to be or help the industry leads within the private sector. There's a lot of investment going into the public sector and looking at new technologies, specifically hydrogen up in Aberdeen and Dundee, etc. And it's the biggest polluter is actually the private sector. So government, I think, need to look at how they invest in the private sector and make sure that if, you know, we are going to become carbon neutral by 2045, which actually within transport logistics is a big ask, I'll be honest. You know, we need to be in a comparative playing field so that the pricing that Martin said is, you know, not as onerous as, you know, it's going to be to convert to greener fleets. So it might be, you know, whether it be subsidies and the vehicles being purchased in similar ways when electric cars came to market, and they were subsidised, the government potentially need to look at doing that, or subsidy of fuel if there's a difference in price between diesel and, say, hydrogen or LPG or biofuels, whatever that might be. Because, you know, logistics is one of the highest costs to food distribution, our vehicles and the fuel, as is our staffing costs, and both of those are on the rise at this point. We are starting to see, I'll be honest, wholesale is a squeezed middle. It's been spoken about often. We are distributing on behalf of the producers who are sending price rises down our way, but we can't rise our cost prices of goods up any more at this end, because we are certainly dictated to partly by the multiples and the discounters, because we're selling into the convenience stores who can't raise their prices much more than supermarket, otherwise they become uncompetitive. So we are squeezed at how much we can raise our price. And 1.3% net margins, we are a very much a high volume, low turnover business. And in the last survey that I alluded to earlier, 90% of our members are seeing cost prices come in from their suppliers, but only 62% of them have managed to increase their cost price out. So our margins are becoming tighter. So government are going to have to invest in supply chain and wholesalers in order to enable us to meet the ambitions of 2045.
Thank you.
And just to build on that, from within the food manufacturing side of things, there are a couple of things. Operation has a net zero by 2040 ambition. Our members have reduced in the UK on-site carbon emissions by 55%, so 5 years early from our 2025 target. So there's a good trajectory there. But there are a couple of big questions, really. The first is around energy production in Scotland. That's actually easier than the rest of the UK. And then the second one is around heat. We use a lot of ovens to bake biscuits and so on, and that's a bigger and more difficult question, I think, for the industry to address in the short term, particularly as there's a question over a move to either electricity or to hydrogen, if that's feasible. So there are a number of these significant investment decisions that businesses will need to make on the road to net zero, and it's in those kind of policy worlds and policy decisions that it's important that there is, as others have said, plenty of time to make that change and support where new technology is several magnitudes more expensive than conventional technology.
Thank you. Can I possibly come in and ask Pete or John, with regards to the Scottish Greengrocers Federation, what impact do these environmental challenges have in your business? So it may be packaging, reduced packaging, or sell-by dates or use-by dates. Do you see issues that you're going to have to tackle in the future with strengthening environmental policies?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'm happy to say something about that. Your point about packaging and so on is a good one, but I think those issues don't impact on us too much. But one thing I would like to mention, to go back to the question about government policy, is that, and sorry if this sounds like a plea for money, that's because it is. A few years ago, we developed a programme with Zero Waste Scotland, which provided funding for retailers, convenience retailers, to carry out eco-friendly and energy-efficient refits of their stores. So typically, this would be looking at smart lighting, energy-efficient chillers, smart metering, and so on. And it was very, very successful. And it actually shifted the dial on the whole way that I think our members were looking at how energy-efficient and how eco-friendly their stores were. And it helped to move the sector, I think, towards a greater understanding and a greater need for the whole move to net zero. So that project was very, very, very successful. The programme that Pete mentions, Go Local, which again is helping people to make connections with local suppliers based on government funding. I suppose the key message here for me is that a small amount of investment in a small business can actually have a very big impact, not just on the business itself, but on these wider policy issues that we're trying to address: supply chain, food supply, move to net zero. Another key thing was that they were developed in partnership with ourselves, with the industry. Government just didn't develop a programme that it hoped would be successful. We worked together with Zero Waste, we worked together with the government to develop these programmes, and they've been very successful. So I think that targeted funding with clear outcomes, developed in partnership with industry, can actually have a very big impact. Small amounts of investment in a small business can actually have a really big impact.
Thank you. We'll now move on to questions from Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much. It was related to some of the issues about the supply chain that came up in the previous panel, and it was really just to ask whether you're noticing some of the same problems around changes to the certification of imports as you have been, or analogous problems to the problems you've experienced around exports post-Brexit. So it's to ask about the impact on your own businesses with regards to the changes in certification to imports that are expected sometime between October and January.
David Thompson.
So I'll start with that, yeah, if that's okay. So the answer is yes, and that comes in three different ways. So the first is around the paperwork changes and implementation of new rules for imports, and obviously an element of that, the actual checking of documentation, has been delayed until January. So we're still really waiting to see how that works and it impacts on our members when they're importing raw materials and packaging from Europe in particular. I think the second bit around this is the bit which I think James Withers mentioned, which is around there's a quid pro quo around export and import controls, it's very difficult to negotiate with Europe to make things easier and simpler in terms of things moving back and forward across the border. So there's a kind of political negotiations element of that. And then the last bit is just the general issue of importing due to the massive cost increases in international shipping. So one of our members has told us that a container used to cost £2,000 to come from China and now costs £20,000. So not just the cost, but the delays and everything there are causing significant issues. So we think there's still more pain to come on imports as the UK begins to put in place the proper long-term regime.
Thank you. Maybe move on to Colin Smith.
I mean, most of our the majority of our members aren't directly importing. They are relying on the likes of David's members doing the importing. But it is a concern that it's just another potential burden, another potential problem waiting in the wings to hit the food supply chain at a time when we're already really creaking at the sides and we are stretched anymore. And I don't know what might happen. The only thing that we have noticed on the import side from Europe is longer lead times. Some of the goods that we import are taking from instead of 2 weeks, 4 weeks. Reduction in some frozen goods coming in, particularly meats and fresh produce. That's potentially partly because of the limited frozen capacity that's available in the UK, so they're not able to bring in as much because we've not got the capacity to store it. But I can't really answer much more on that one, I'm afraid.
And Martin?
Well, I guess our industry is the guys that are moving the goods for David's industry and Colin's industry. So any further delays in the process add costs. But we can also link this back to the skill shortage directly, because one of the issues we have as an industry is the image of the industry as a place to come and work. And so if the public are seeing queues at ports or they're hearing of downtime additional cost from sitting waiting on goods to be loaded, unloaded at ports or railheads, etc., doesn't do anything for the image of the industry. And we want to be attracting people to come into this industry. And so any additional cost that's added, any additional delays that are added, all have to be factored into that 1.3% profit that Colin mentioned earlier on.
Okay, thank you.
Was again related to Europe, again related to the supply chain. Given that the labour shortages, which you've described in the last panel, have described, are occurring at the very time when we're trying to rebuild the economy post-COVID, I noticed that the last panel, or one of them, made a case for what he called COVID recovery visas. Do you think there's a need for the UK government to intervene with some kind of emergency measure of that kind to release some of the strain that there is on the labour supply just now?
Again, so I was a co-signatory of the letter that was mentioned in the last thing, where there was a very clear ask for a 12-month COVID recovery visa to try and find a way to unleash businesses, allow them to attract more people from other parts of Europe and potentially the world, in order for that to happen for a short period of time as we try and get over this perfect storm. So that would be one thing. There are lots of other things that are required. But as a way to exacerbate the short-term issue, it might be a tool that helps.
Anyone else, Colin?
Yeah, I would agree completely with what's been said. It would be very useful. It's not a silver bullet, and it's not going to cure everything. But I also think we should be looking at people who have left the industry, whether that be through retirement or just being disenfranchised with the industry. So one of the barriers, or two of the barriers, are obviously there's a cost attached to a medical if you're going to come back into the industry. So perhaps financial help with that, and I also think we should be reviewing the CPC requirement, which again could be a block for those who want to return. Even if they're only wanting to do a couple of shifts a week, then that's one or two deliveries that are covered that ordinarily wouldn't be recovered. So temporary visa, absolutely, shortage occupation list, and those other reviews for CPC and medicals.
Okay, anybody else like to come in on that question? Colin.
Yeah, if I may, we were also co-signatories to the letter, and as Martin said, this isn't a silver bullet. It's about long term how we get people into the food and drink sector and the wholesale sector that we're here to represent. In our last market survey, we had asked members whether they thought a wholesale task force should be set up. And there was an overwhelming response for that, and that would be wholesale task force to work with Scottish Government on looking at recovery of the food supply chain and wholesale, but also navigating back to recovery through greener, more sustainable jobs, looking at the skills within the wholesale distribution channel, and making it attractive for everyone, and especially the younger workforce. I said earlier on, we're needing people within our warehouses, but it's not just pickers. In fact, we aren't just pickers and packers or box movers. We are educators of the food and drink supply chain. 80% of the knowledge of a retailer comes from the wholesaler. The chefs in our restaurants use our members' development kitchens for their next culinary desires or concoctions. So, when we're looking at a sector, it is about, the digital skills professionals, data analysts, drivers, decarbonisation experts, sales and marketing professionals, debt and finance advisors. These are all skills that we have within our businesses. Yet it's not known, and it's how do we use DYW Skills Development Scotland to actually go out and promote that in schools, colleges, universities, so that people know that those skills can be used in this vital economy to keep people fed and the fuels moving.
Thank you. We'll now move on to questions from Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener. David, I've got a specific question for you for something that you mentioned right at the very start of your opening. You talked about the health connections with food and the potential clash between UK regulations and or English regulations and Scottish regulations through the UK Internal Market Act. Can you expand on that for me, please? But also, I wanted to talk about the Food Process and Marketing Cooperation Grant Scheme The one that has just been released has got a very short time frame, and I think we need to be asking the Scottish Government why there is such a short time frame to get that application from conception through to completion before you can ask for the money for it. You've already talked on the Go Local Fund, Pete, and Colin already talked about the Go Local Fund, which I think is a great initiative. But I'll leave it at that just now because I know we're running out of time.
Okay, thanks, Jim. So there are on the kind of health regulations of the Internal Market Act. There are two different things here. So the clash of the health regulations is based on what foods are deemed to be not healthy, and therefore under the type of regulation, and then also the types of restriction that are placed on those on those foods. We had a set of proposals that were brought forward by the previous Scottish Government, and they categorised food in certain ways. We had some problems with that, and also they had categorised where you were and weren't allowed to display. And in particular, we had issues where that disbenefited small and medium enterprises. The UK proposals for England are much more wide-ranging in terms of foods that are covered. And talk about different sets of bans, including, for example, online banning and others, but only for businesses that have over 250 staff, however you manage to do that. So already you can see there will be differences in approach. Supermarkets will have different regulations to work to, and food manufacturers will need to understand where and how their products can be promoted in order not to run afoul of whatever laws are eventually introduced. So you can see that there's quite a large opportunity for confusion there. The Internal Market Act is more about how you produce food and where it can be sold. And in particular, it has an impact on if we have higher production standards in Scotland than other parts of the UK, or even in Wales than other parts of the UK. Food across the whole of the UK can still be sold in Scotland, England and Wales. Northern Ireland is a unique case because of the Northern Ireland Protocol. So, again, there is a likelihood of confusion about how that works. And in particular, I can foresee quite an issue in terms of how it's implemented by local environmental health officers who are checking up on things. So there's you know, quite a lot that food businesses need to be probably without even knowing that they will. And lastly, on food grants, I agree it was disappointing that we had only until the end of the year to not just apply for the food grant, but actually to get all your invoices out and the work done by the end of the year. I understand it's because the Scottish Government, you know, quite understandably, is on annualised budgeting at the moment, so they couldn't commit beyond that. However, there is some good news in that they're already saying that they will consider projects for the next financial year. I think the thing I would ask the committee to consider is how do we get a stable budget that allows the Scottish Government as food division to and others to plan for you know, longer term investments. Because if we're talking about you know putting in new lines, if we're talking about that kind of significant investment, which I think we'd all want to see in the race to net zero, then you need a longer lead time and a longer build time than the time that's been made available this time round.
Can I just clarify one point there, David? Scottish Government introduced the minimum pricing or unit for alcohol. Is that the kind of area where we may run into difficulty?
My understanding is yes. So not with minimum unit pricing, because that was already extant legislation. But anything like that that comes forward now could potentially be caught by the Internal Market Act, and I would leave it to the lawyers to work out precisely where that would be.
Thank you.
Okay. I'll move on to our final questions from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. Sorry, David, I'm going to ask you a question here again. It was something that you said in your opening remarks regarding obesity and our obesity strategy, particularly the Scottish Government's aim to reduce childhood obesity by half by 2030. And that's quite a big challenge. Obviously, it's been delayed and we yet await the programme for government. However, what impact will that have on the food and drink industry with regards to reducing salt, fat, sugar, etc., and also the impact it will have on promotions? And that might actually appeal to Pete to answer as well.
Okay, so I mean, the tackling obesity is hugely important for Scotland. It's hugely important for the UK, and it's hugely important for the food industry. It's you know, something that we can all get behind. That's why we are actually working with the Scottish Government on our reformulation project. So that is supporting small and medium-sized enterprises in Scotland to reduce fat, salt, and sugar, and actually increase in our diet, like fibre. That has had an enormous response. We have engaged with over 400 companies in Scotland. We're already on the way to taking millions of calories out of the Scottish shopping basket. So it's been a real success for a very, very small investment over the past couple of years. And we also opened a bit of challenge funding last year for companies, which was oversubscribed. And for example, McSween of Edinburgh have used the funds to adapt traditional products to make such as haggis, by pudding, to make a healthier, low-fat, lower-fat version. So there's real activity, which is really good. I think the harder part of the conversation is around regulation and its impact on the industry. We've always been very clear that government needs to be very careful about the impact on small and medium-sized enterprises. We all want to support a vibrant and diverse food industry in Scotland. Some of those products are not what we fall in the category of healthier products, but you could quite heavily affect some SMEs with some of the measures that were being supported. So whatever regulation comes in, the food industry will adapt and work towards and want to help deliver our Scotland, where we are able to reduce childhood obesity. But I think we need to be very careful about the measures that we implement to make sure they're not disproportionately affecting, in particular.
Thank you. Does
Pete
want to add anything to the question?
Do you want me to go, John?
Pete, do you want to add anything to the question regarding reducing childhood obesity and the impact and challenges it might have?
Sure. We've been running a programme called the SGF Healthy Living Programme since 2004 to deliver a healthier lifestyle in deprived areas, and that's been extremely successful. And again, I would echo some of the remarks that David has just made regarding the effect it has on SMEs. But also, you know, every single piece of legislation that keeps coming out of government affects our sector. And the moratorium of policies would really be of benefit, you know, a bit of breathing space for our sector. I mean, even if you look at it this year, you know, the amount of policies that we've had, the Nassau's law that we've had to now comply with from the 1st of October. We've been working with our colleagues at FSS. There is so much legislation, the DRS system that's going to be coming through. And, you know, if you listen to colleagues earlier on regarding the haulage problems, how on earth are we supposed to deliver a world-class system that's going to have a huge problem with drivers? There is so much legislation that we have to deal with, that we have to be very, very careful that we don't drive businesses out of business.
Thank you very much. Excuse the pun, but that's plenty of food for thought. It's been a very informative session, and it will certainly help us form our business planning through the session this year. So thank you all very much for joining us. We will now move into a private session. Thank you.